Hello, I'm Dr. Suraj Panchal. Today in this session, I'll be dealing with the antipsychotic agents part 3. However, in the part 1 and part 2, we saw the anatomical and the physiological basis of antipsychotic agents and its relevance to schizophrenia. In the part 2, I mostly covered the classification proper, like we divided into typical, also known as conventional first generation, and then atypical, also known as second generation. And then we went on to discuss the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics, then the adverse effect profile. So in this session, I will be mostly concentrating on the atypical agents, starting with the prototype atypical antipsychotic agent with clozapine. Indications of antipsychotics in general, the newer preparations available in the market of both typical and atypical antipsychotic agents, and let's see the recent advances. Now, before going into the clozapine, which is a prototype atypical antipsychotic agents, just brush up the atypical antipsychotic agents once again. As I said, like clozapine is a prototypic atypical antipsychotic agents. The other examples were olanzapine, quetiapine, loxapine, acinapine, risperidone, paliperidone, ziprasidone, iloperidone, aripiprazole, cariprazine, and pimavanserin. So let me concentrate on the prototype atypical antipsychotic agent, that is clozapine. The mechanism of action by which clozapine acts is mainly by blocking the 5-HT2A receptors when compared to D2 receptor. That's why we discussed, even in atypical, why exactly these types of drugs are called as atypical, for the fact that they mostly acts by having a higher affinity to the 5-HT2 receptors, and when compared to D2 receptors, and with this tendency, it makes to have a lesser potential to cause extrapyramidal symptoms and low chances of hyperprolactinemia. When you consider the mechanism of action, you will see that this clozapine improves the positive symptoms, that is basically by blocking the D2 receptors on the mesolimbic pathway. As well, it also improves the negative symptoms, cognition impairment, as well as the vocational functioning. The mechanism by which clozapine acts by improving these symptoms, especially the negative symptoms and the cognition impairment, is by acting upon the 5-HT2A receptor, that is by antagonism. In the last session, we discussed that there is a cortical activity is decreased in case of schizophrenia. So therefore, decreased activity of the 5-HT2A and then a decreased D2 or the dopaminergic activity in the cortical system or the pathways responsible for negative symptoms. So therefore, upon blocking the 5-HT2A receptors, it tend to increase the dopamine level, which helps to improve the negative symptoms as well as the cognition. That's the rationale of using, clozapine, especially in a patient who have predominant negative symptoms. Okay. And that's why you see that because of its ability to improve both the positive as well as the negative symptoms, and then to improve the cognition, therefore they obviously will become a drug of choice in case of resistant or the refractory type of schizophrenia. So therefore, it is considered to be a reserved drug. Okay, it's not used in all the cases of schizophrenia. So therefore, aripiprazole, like other atypical, comes into picture initially, and only the clozapine comes into picture as a reserved drug, for the fact that it is also useful in the treatment resistant schizophrenia. The other indications that we discussed based upon its pharmacodynamic property, it is used in the schizophrenia with the predominant negative symptoms. In the initial sessions, in the last, especially in the part 2 session, I discussed even that clozapine is an atypical antipsychotic, which is used even in case of tardive dyskinesias. Okay. Let us see the side effects. One of the important, it can be an emergency situation, that is agranulocytosis. Try to remember this important point, which I have highlighted as in Q or as a superscript. This suggests that it is an important point to be remembered and can be an MCQ point of view. Okay, so it is independent of the dose. Why? Because it is immune related or immune mediated. So agranulocytosis, which is seen as an adverse effect profile of the clozapine, is an immune mediated. So therefore the dose does not decide here. So therefore it becomes an independent of the dose. So okay, this can be an option in the MCQs. Okay, it is not a dose dependent. Seizures, it's a dose dependent. Okay, the other emergency condition can arise because of the clozapine therapy is myocarditis. The fourth adverse effect, weight gain. Obviously, it is because of the H1 blockade we discussed in the initial session of part 2. Sedation, once again, because of the H1 receptors. Dyslipidemia and newer onset of type 2 diabetic mellitus. Dyslipidemia, the one important component we discussed was increase in triglyceride. So why there is an increase in triglyceride? Why? Because there is an insulin resistance because of the involvement of the many 5-HT receptors. Because of the insulin resistance, there tend to be an increased lipolysis condition, which increases the free fatty acid level, which acts as a source for the triglyceride synthesis. So therefore, you will see that dyslipidemia, one important component which is increased is triglycerides. Of course, there are anticholinergic side effects, obviously because of its potential to block the M1 type of receptors. Let us go into the other examples of atypical antipsychotic, olanzapine. Olanzapine is more potent than clozapine. Mechanisms remain same, that is, it acts by blocking the 5-HT2A receptor more when compared to D2 receptors. So let us try to concentrate some of the other properties which can be a MCQ point of view. Other properties is it blocks the H1 receptor, alpha-1 receptor and muscarinic receptor. Therefore, you will see that weight gain because of H1 blockade. We also saw that what is the physiological role of serotonin and the histamine on the hypothalamus, that it causes anorexia. So therefore, upon blockade, it can increase the appetite and can cause weight gain. Anticholinergic side effect, of course, because of M1 blockade. Let us see some other properties. They also have a tendency to block the 5-HT2C, a subtype receptor of the serotonin, and also 5-HT7 receptor. So therefore, it's been seen that in the trials, once these subtypes receptors of serotonin are blocked, they tend to improve the mood symptoms. So therefore, it can be an important point of view for the MCQs. Since it improves the mood symptoms by blocking these two subset of receptors, it can be used therefore in case of bipolar disorder as well as in case of treatment-resistant depression. Okay, the other side effects being dyslipidemia, like other antitypical antipsychotics, newer onset type 2 diabetic, seizures, and in trials they also seen that they have high risk of causing stroke. Let us come to the other type of one more type of atypical antipsychotic, that is quetiapine. The mechanisms remain same, that is by blocking the 5-HT2A receptor. And then let us see some of the other important properties. One of the important metabolites of quetiapine is norquetiapine. And this has an important property of blocking the norepinephrine transporter as well as 5-HT2C subtype receptor of serotonin. So therefore, upon blockade of this, it is known to increase the neurotransmission of norepinephrine, which plays an important role in the treatment of depression. Okay, so therefore, once again, this can be an MCQ question, which among the following atypical antipsychotic have a role in, treating depression. Okay, this is one of the drug example, and the mechanism is by blocking the norepinephrine transporter. It also has a 5-HT1A partial agonistic activity. Therefore, it has anxiolytic property, which can be helpful once again in the anxious patient in depressions. And the other property being H1 antagonism. Okay, because of this property, it causes sedation, and because of once again causing the sedative as an sedation as an the effect of H1 antagonism. So therefore, it can be used in the treatment of insomnia. Therefore, you will see that very few drug among the atypical antipsychotics used in the treatment of insomnia. It will be only the quetiapine, because once again of its ability to blockade the H1 antagonism. So based on this property, we'll correlate that it is also useful in the treatment of bipolar depression, which we discussed. And then it is also used in the treatment of unipolar depression along with the SSRI, that is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SNRIs, that is selective non-nephrine reuptake inhibitors. Of course, it is not used as a single drug. It has to be combined with some other antidepressant drugs. Acinapine, okay, it has the binding properties of blocking the 5-HT2A receptor. Therefore, the antipsychotic effects is attributable because of blockade to these receptors. However, it also has an ability to inhibit 5-HT2C as well as alpha-2 receptors. So these two are responsible for increasing the serotonin level and norepinephrine level centrally. So therefore, once again, this drug has an antidepressant effect. Okay. However, it also has an ability to blockade the H1 type of receptor. Coming on to the drug zotepine, it has an antagonistic activity at the 5-HT2C, alpha-2, 5-HT7 and norepinephrine transporter, which play an important role and attributes to the antidepressant property of the zotepine. The other properties worth to remember is its ability to cause a partial agonism at the 5-HT1A. Therefore, an anxiolytic property may be attributable to the zotepine because of this property. And they tend to cause prolongation of the QT interval probably by blocking the delayed inward rectifying potassium channel, which we discussed in the initial session of the previous class. Coming on to the risperidone, the active metabolite of the risperidone is paliperidone, and they have a tendency to block the dopamine receptor when given in high dose. So therefore, you will see that in a typical antipsychotics, the chances of extrapyramidal symptom is more with the risperidone and its metabolite like paliperidone. However, it has a tendency to increase the prolactin level even when given on the therapeutic or on the lower doses. The other property, it also blocks the alpha-1 receptor attributable to orthostatic hypotension. Coming on to the one of the important drug in the atypical antipsychotic, that is aripiprazole. Aripiprazole has a partial agonistic activity at the 5-HT1A and D2 receptor. Remember the importance of D2 receptor. So therefore, since it has a partial agonistic activity, especially at the D2 receptor, it has reduced tendency of extrapyramidal symptom and hyperprolactinemia. The other property being it acts as a weak antagonist at D2 receptor and 5-HT2A receptor. It has a partial agonistic activity at the 5-HT1A receptor and antagonism at 5-HT7, which once again attributes to its antidepressant action. In the last class, we also discussed the importance of, you know, aripiprazole, especially when it comes to adverse effect profile and the endocrine part. We saw that it is a drug which has a very, very low tendency to cause weight gain and then dyslipidemic potential and the newer onset type 2 diabetes. So among the atypical antipsychotics, we discussed that aripiprazole, acinapine and ziprasidone has a very less tendency to cause weight gain, dyslipidemia and new onset type 2 diabetic mellitus. Coming on to the indications of antipsychotic agents in general, obviously the first is schizophrenia. These days usually starts with the atypical antipsychotic agents. However, the atypical antipsychotic agents, which is preferred one, is aripiprazole and the ziprasidone. Also the fact that we know that typical antipsychotic agents, why they are not started initially, because of their higher tendency to cause, you know, adverse effects in the form of extrapyramidal symptoms and also their adverse effect profile on the negative symptoms, which we discussed in the initial class discussion. However, in case of refractory cases of schizophrenia, we discussed that clozapine is the drug of choice. And it is the only drug among the entire antipsychotic drugs which has a tendency to decrease the suicide. Okay, this can be once again an MCQ question. Those patients who has a predominant positive symptoms, typical antipsychotics plays an important role as a first line. We already discussed what is the importance of olanzapine and it's useful in the mania and the bipolar disorder. Obviously, the reason being olanzapine, you know, they have a tendency, you know, to block the 5-HT2 a C receptor and 5-HT7 receptor, which we discussed, which improves the mood symptoms. So therefore, it can be used in case of bipolar. And then in case of depression, norquetiapine, by its ability to inhibit the norepinephrine transporter, therefore making available norepinephrine in the synaptic cleft for longer duration. And then we also discussed about the other roles like aripiprazole, olanzapine, and risperidone, which has an important role. Of course, not as a single agent. It is combined with the other antidepressant agents in the treatment of depression. Coming on to the fourth indication, that is Huntington's chorea. A chorea is an important component of Huntington's disease. Let us recall, Huntington's disease, it's an inherited autosomal dominant condition wherein there is a progressive degeneration of the GABAergic neurons, which leads to increase in the dopaminergic activity. So this increase in central dopaminergic activity is responsible some of the involuntary motor movements. So therefore, the treatment of choice, or rather, there is no treatment for the Huntington's disease. It is usually a symptomatic treatment. However, the initial drug which was used in those days, in the earlier days, were haloperidol. Since it has higher tendency of causing adverse effect profile in the form of extrapyramidal symptom, now it is replaced by a drug tetrabenazine, which we discussed in yesterday's recent session, that it acts by blocking the vesicular monoamine transporter 2, which is restricted or predominantly seen in case of dopaminergic neurons, which tend to decrease the dopamine level. So this is the rationale of using the tetrabenazine. Next, coming on to the other indication, Tourette's syndrome. It's a condition wherein it is characterized by, tics. And tics are involuntary, irresistible movements, which can be in the form of motor tics. And, severe tics in case of Tourette syndrome, the drug of choice remains the haloperidol because of its ability to block the dopamine receptor, and it has a higher affinity towards the dopamine receptor. However, in case of less severe form of tics, aripiprazole plays an important role because of its lesser adverse effect profile. However, alpha-2 agonists have also role in the treatment of Tourette syndrome, that is clonidine and guafenicin. The other examples of indications or uses of typical antipsychotics, it is used in autism associated with irritability. The drugs used are risperidone and aripiprazole. Because of its anti-emetic property, like drugs which we discussed in the initial discussion, once again, that is the first generation antipsychotics, that is its ability to block the high density dopamine receptors in the area prostrema, especially the prochlorperazine, it is used as an anti-emetic. And then in insomnia, that is quetiapine, because of its ability to block the H1 receptor and then to cause the sedation. So therefore, these are the various indications of the antipsychotic agents in general. Now let us come on to the topic, which once again is hot in the recent days, like name the antipsychotic agents which are available in Depot formulations. Now, why this Depot formulations or the Depot antipsychotics preparations are available? For the fact that if there is a compliance or adherence problem to a patient who are not taking antipsychotic agents, there are chances of causing relapse. So these Depot injections or formulations, when given, they tend to decrease this relapse rate by staying in the tissue for longer duration. And once the plasma concentration decreases, the tissue concentrates of these drugs are slowly released into the circulation, and then they go on to distribute to the different receptors and occupy for the longer duration. So that's the reason why they are used to prevent the relapse as a long-term management of in the treatment of schizophrenia. Let us see what are the drugs available. First generation antipsychotics, The drugs available in the form of Depot injections are flufenazine deconate, haloperidol deconate, perphenazine deconate, and zuclopentixol deconate. Among the atypical or the second generation antipsychotics, the drugs which are available as Depot injections are aripiprazole monohydrate, aripiprazole lauraxil, L-A-U-R-O-X-I-L, olanzapine palmoate, paliperidone palmitate, and risperidone microspear. So the question can be, which among the following is a Depot injection or antipsychotic agents which is available in the form of Depot formulation, or it can be all of the following or the available as the long-term management or used as in long in the treatment of long-term management of schizophrenia except. Okay, so this can be, you know, twisted in different forms. So try to remember these examples among the first generation as well in the second generation antipsychotic agents. Now coming on to the recent advances part, the drug which I highlighted in the class classification, that is pimavanserine, it is a 5-HT2A inverse agonist, and it is used in the condition known as Parkinson's disease psychosis. Now, what is the rationale of using this drug as an inverse agonist in the Parkinson's disease psychosis is, in the Parkinson's disease, the pathological body like Leeway body, which are formed upon long term, they can cause degeneration or the loss of serotonin raphe neuron. Because of this effect, it can cause upregulation of the cortical 5-HT2A receptor, which is responsible for causing the increased dopaminergic activity. We know that increase in dopaminergic activity is responsible for psychosis. So therefore, this acts as a target for the treatment for the psychosis. That is, the inverse agonist of 5-HT2A will decrease the dopaminergic activity, therefore decreasing the psychotic component in the Parkinson's disease. So therefore, this is the rationale of using the pimavanserin in the treatment of Parkinson's disease psychosis. However, the half-life of this drug is 57 hours. Thank you. That's all from this part 3 session. I hope you will be able to be integrated once you see the part 1 and part 2 lectures. And if you like this whole session of part 1, part 2 and part 3, and which might have helped you to understand the concept better, please share and subscribe for the further notifications in future. Thank you.